What's going on, guys? A few months ago on the Med School Insider channel, I made a video about whether or not USMLE Step 1 should be pass-fail, and now it's actually happening. And this is huge, massive, massive news. I've been talking to a lot of people about this. In fact, got a text from one of my colleagues, and he said, "Copyright UWorld, please do not save, print, cut, copy, or paste anything while a test is active." Now, there are three components to the change. First, the number of attempts you can take on any USMLE exam is down from 6 to 4, which isn't really a big deal. Most, over 90% of US students pass on their first try. Second, you must pass step 1 before you take step 2 CS. Also not a big deal, kind of makes sense actually. And third, USMLE step 1 is becoming pass fail. This is obviously the one that everyone is losing their minds about. So why is this so important? USMLE Step 1 is arguably the most important test a doctor would take in their life. More important than the MCAT, or Step 2, Step 3, or any board exam. The first 2 years at most medical schools were very heavily focused on optimizing a student's performance for Step 1. After all, it's a very important objective measurement used by residency admissions committees. And if you want to go into something super competitive, like dermatology, plastic surgery, then it's so hard to get in unless you have a high Step 1 score, because a lot of these residency adcoms, they actually have high Step 1 cutoffs. This is also big news for a lot of test prep companies that essentially focus on Step 1 prep. You know, Boards and Beyond, Golian, Sketchy, First Aid, USMLE RX, UWorld, all these companies focus a lot of energy on Step 1. Does that mean they're going out of business? No, and we're gonna talk about that shortly. And if you go on Reddit, you're gonna see a lot of DOs, IMGs, or students at lower ranked med schools really stressing about not being able to differentiate themselves now that Step 1 is going to be pass-fail, and I don't necessarily agree with this either. So why did this happen? Per the official report, a large part of the decision actually came down to wanting to improve student well-being and also help ease that transition between medical school and then residency. As you guys know, medical student and resident burnout, depression, and suicide are huge issues that don't get enough attention, and we obviously need to do something about it. And obviously it's something that I care very deeply about. As you can see. Now they're hoping that by making this test pass-fail, that reduces the anxiety of needing to score well on Step 1 rather than just needing to pass, and that will hopefully improve student well-being. Proponents of making Step 1 pass-fail also emphasize that it's not a very reliable indicator of how good of a doctor you're gonna be. I mean, after all, it tests on a lot of really obscure biochemistry and small nuances that aren't all that clinically relevant. So what does this all mean? Okay, this is my favorite part. Let's set the record straight. Now I've seen a couple videos and I've seen a lot of comments on Reddit. What I think a lot of people are failing to understand is that in a complex system, such as residency applications, that's multifactorial, has a lot of variables, if you change one variable, that doesn't happen in a vacuum. You have to see how changing that one variable is going to influence all the other variables. Similarly, a lot of people who are advocating and excited about Step 1 being pass-fail point to their own experience or their upcoming experience with the stress of Step 1 and the anxiety and the burnout and all those negative emotions. But here's the thing, that's not because of Step 1. It's a symptom of a broken system, not due to Step 1 inherently. I get it, Step 1 is super stressful. I've been there. But here's the thing, making Step 1 pass-fail doesn't make plastic surgery or dermatology any less competitive. Instead, you're gonna have other factors, other variables, other parts of your application, whether objective or subjective, being weighed more heavily, and there's pros and cons that do come with that. First and most obviously, Step 2 CK is retaining its numerical scoring. It's not becoming pass-fail, so it's more or less going to replace Step 1 as that metric. And the good news about this is that Step 2 CK is a much more reliable indicator for clinical performance because the test is much more clinically relevant than, you know, spitting out and regurgitating some biochemistry pathways. But the bad news is that if you bombed Step 1, you could always make up for it with Step 2 CK when it came time to applying for residency. But now with Step 2 CK, if you bomb it, there's no test you can use to make up for it. So you can actually argue that you are increasing stress and anxiety in this case. I think a large part of the argument and discussion about Step 1 being pass-fail is driven by emotions and memories of the exam, more so than actually logically going through, okay, if we do this, what are the repercussions, the next steps that will trickle down or domino effect? I mean, next thing you know, we're gonna say that fetuses are too stressed by their upcoming newborn Apgar scores, and we gotta make Apgar scoring pass-fail too. Shout out to Mr. Fartbutt on Reddit for that insight. So for all the IMGs and DOs and students at lower ranked schools that were concerned about not being able to set themselves apart, understand that Step 2 CK is still numerical, and that's in large part going to replace Step 1. But it's also likely that other factors in your application are going to become more important. So for example, if you look at the actual literature, looking at program directors in plastic surgery, they consistently rank letters of recommendation as the number one most important factor. And this does make a lot of sense in a field like plastic surgery, very small, most of the faculty more or less know one another, But this is gonna be different from specialty to specialty, and most specialties aren't as small as plastic surgery. But residency admissions committees still need objective data, right? Because they had so many applicants and they need to sift and sort through all those applicants. So looking at clinical evaluations, it's too subjective. It's not gonna be a good or meaningful replacement. So they're gonna play up things like the dean's letter. And the dean's letter does include some language that objectively states how that student performed in comparison with their classmates. For example, if a dean's letter says a student is excellent versus good, that can indicate which quartile in the class they were in. And some letters can actually get more granular than that too. Research will become more important too, the number of publications and abstracts and presentations that you have. But the sad thing is, research is also a game, and that's gonna have a lot of issues as well. Research for a lot of us is more about getting into a good residency and less about actually advancing the scientific community. And I mean, I'm guilty of that too. I have over 60 or over 65 publications and abstracts, and you can see the full list on my website, kevinjabal.com. But I'll admit, I mean, how many of those actually changed patient care in a meaningful way? So putting emphasis on research actually has some of its own issues as well. I think standardized evaluation forms are gonna become more common and mandatory across more specialties. So for example, in emergency medicine, they have the SLOE. That's the standardized letter of evaluation. Plastic surgery has something very similar, and it's a good way to add a layer of objectivity to one's evaluation. We don't know if there are going to be other changes as well, like how many residency programs a med student can apply to, or whether or not Step 2 CK will also become pass-fail at some point. Now, if these other changes do arise, that's obviously going to alter our conversation. Regardless, this isn't going to be happening until January of 2022 at the earliest. So in the meantime, I mean, just proceed as normal. Keep trying to be the best student you can be. Do well on your research, impress your seniors, optimize everything you can, and just be the best student that you can be. Now, if you need help with Step 2 CK, at Med School Insiders, we specialize in tutoring for this exam. Now, I scored a 267 on this test, and since then, I've further honed and given a lot of thought and energy towards how to optimize for that test. And a lot of my students, or even other tutor students, have surpassed me and have scored beyond a 267, which I think is awesome. Anyway, thanks for watching. Much love to you all, and I'll see you guys at that next one.